Hello and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Daggerfall. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading Brief History of the Empire Part 1, which I bought right here in Mordor's General Market in the city of Daggerfall. A Brief History of the Empire Part 2. Volume 1 of this series described in brief the lives of the first 8 emperors of the Septim Dynasty, beginning with the forebear Tiber Septim and ending with his great-great-great-great-grandniece, Kintira II. Kintira's murder in Glenpoint while in captivity is considered by some to be the end of the pure strain of Septim blood. Certainly, it marks the end of something. Uriel II not only proclaimed himself Emperor of Tamriel, but also proclaimed himself Uriel Septim III, taking a surname as a title. In truth, his surname was Uriel Mantiarco from his father. In time, Uriel III was deposed and his crimes reviled, but the tradition of taking the name Septim as a title for the Emperor of Tamriel did not die with him. For 6 years, the War of the Red Diamond tore apart the Empire. The combatants were the 3 surviving children of Pelagius II, Potemma, Sephorus, and Magnus, and their offspring. Potemma, of course, supported her son Uriel III and had the support of all of Skyrim and Northern Morrowind. With the efforts of Sephorus and Magnus, High Rock turned. Hammerfell, Somerset Isle, Valenwood, elsewhere, and Black Marsh were divided, but most kings supported Sephorus and Magnus. In the Third Era, 127, Uriel III was captured at the Battle of Ichidag in Hammerfell. En route to his trial in the Imperial City, a mob overtook his carriage and burned him alive within it. His captor and uncle continued on to the Imperial City, and by common acclaim was proclaimed Sephorus I, Emperor of Tamriel. Sephorus's reign is marked by nothing but war. By all accounts, he was a kind and intelligent man, but what Tamriel needed was a great warrior, and he was that. It took an additional 10 years of constant warfare for him to defeat his sister Potemma. The so-called Wolf Queen of Solitude died in the siege of her city-state in the year 137. Sephorus only survived his sister by 3 years. Sephorus never had the time during the war years to marry, so it was his brother, the 4th child of Pelagius III, who assumed the throne. The Emperor Magnus was elderly, and the business of punishing the traitorous kings of the War of the Red Diamond drained much of his health. Legend also accuses Magnus's son and heir, Pelagius III, of murder, but that seems very unlikely. For no other reason, Pelagius was King of Solitude following the death of Potemma and seldom visited the Imperial City. Pelagius III, sometimes called Pelagius the Mad, was proclaimed emperor in the 145th year of the Third Era. Almost from the start, his eccentricities of behavior was noted. He embarrassed dignitaries, offended his vassal kings, and on one occasion marked the end of a grand ball by attempting to hang himself. His long-suffering wife was finally awarded the regency of Tamriel, and Pelagius III was sent to a series of healers and asylums until his death in the Third Era, 153, at the age of 34. The Empress Regent of Tamriel was proclaimed Empress Kataraya I upon the death of her husband. Some who do not mark the end of the Septim bloodline with the death of Kintira II consider the ascendancy of this dark elf woman as the true mark. Her defenders assert that though Kataraya was not descended from Tiber, the son she had with Pelagius was, so the chain does continue. Despite the racist assertions to the contrary, Kataraya's 46-year reign was one of the most glorious in Tamriel's history. Uncomfortable in the Imperial City, Kataraya traveled extensively throughout the Empire, such as no emperor ever had since Tiber's day. She repaired much of the damage the broken alliances and bungled diplomacy had created. The people of Tamriel came to love their empress far more than the nobility did. Kataraya's death in a minor skirmish in Black Marsh is a favorite source for conspiracy-minded historians. the Sage Montalius' discovery of a disenfranchised branch of the Septim family's involvement with the skirmish was a revelation indeed. When Cassinder assumed the throne at the death of his mother, he was already middle-aged. Only half-elven, he aged like a Breton. In fact, he had left the rule of Wayrest to his half-brother Uriel due to poor health. Nevertheless, as the only true blood relation of Pelagius, and thus Tiber, he was pressed into accepting the throne. To no one's surprise, the Emperor Cassinder's reign did not last long. In 2 years, he was dead. Uriel Lariat, Cassinder's half-brother, the child of Kataria I, and her imperial consort Lariat, left the kingdom of Wayrest to reign as Uriel IV. Legally, Uriel IV was a septim. Cassinder had accepted him into the family when he had become king of Wayrest. Nevertheless, to the council and the people of Tamriel, he was a bastard child of Kataria. Uriel did not possess the dynamism of his mother, and his long 43-year reign was a hotbed of sedition. Uriel IV's story is told in the third volume of this series. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Daggerfall, Brief History of the Empire, Part 2.